I got a question tonight that came up actually after the morning meeting this morning. And when I was talking a little bit about the fact that when Jesus Christ died on the cross, that he suffered our second death at the cross. And someone asked me after, as they were going out, when Jesus died, did he go to hell? And the idea is that after he died and he goes into the heart of the earth, did he go to hell? Well, the answer is yes, in the sense that hell had two compartments to it, one the torment and one the paradise. He told the thief, "Today shall thou be with me in paradise." So which compartment in hell did he go to? He went to the paradise compartment. He did not go to the torment side. Now, there is a teaching that says he went to the torment side. And that teaching is something that in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse number 7, Paul says, "But refuse profane and old wives' fables, and exercise yourself unto godliness." The teaching that Jesus Christ, when he died on the cross, after he died on the cross, went down into the torment section of hell, is what that verse is calling an old wives' fable. It is a doctrine, a teaching that comes out of some of the occult things that are associated with some of the old wives' fables that hung around in Greek mythology and the mythologies of the world. So you need to understand that it is a bad idea, bad doctrine, what he calls profane. Something that's profane is something that's bad. Is bad doctrine to tell people that Jesus Christ, after he died, that when he spent the 3 days in the heart of the earth, that he was in the torment section. He did not do that. He suffered your torment of the second death, which is hell and the lake of fire. He suffered that on the cross. And when he said it's finished, that suffering was over with. He did not need to do more later than he did on the cross. Come back with me, if you will, to Psalm 22. And I want you to see this because it's a fascinating study to appreciate some of what went on with the Lord Jesus Christ when he died. Get Psalm 22 in one hand and Matthew chapter 27. And, you know, I'll just mention to you, we've been publishing these little booklets, Listening to Jesus Die. And the one we had published today is called The Words of Suffering. And they refer to Matthew chapter 27, when Jesus is on the cross, and verse number 45, Matthew 27, verse 45. Now, this is also recorded in Mark chapter 15. And by the way, the seven times Christ spoke from the cross, the first three are recorded in Luke and John. Two of them in Luke, one in John. The last three are recorded in Luke and John. Two in John and one in Luke. But this middle cry is only recorded in Matthew and Mark. And that's a fascinating thing, that it's the middle cry, it's about his suffering, and it's just in Matthew and Mark. Matthew 27, verse 45. "Now, from the sixth hour, there was darkness over all the land unto the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, that is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" In the midst of that darkness, if you come with me to Luke chapter 22, the darkness was twofold. First, it was naturally physical darkness where the sun has been hidden. Talmud said that God hung a crepe across the sun so that the sun went into darkness and with its held its shining back. That's the physical darkness. But the physical darkness that surrounded the cross was really a sign of the spiritual darkness that placed Christ on the cross. The spiritual darkness of unbelief. If you look at Luke chapter 22, verse number 52, "Then Jesus said unto the chief priests and captains of the temple and the elders, which were come to him, Be ye come out as against a thief with swords and staves. Now they've come to take him away. Judas is betraying him. When I was daily with you in the temple, you stretched forth no hands against me. But this is your hour and the power of darkness. He understood that when he was being betrayed, that there was a darkness, a spiritual darkness that was being put upon Israel, seeking to control the events. Now, if you come over to chapter 23, Luke 23, verse number 43, Jesus said unto him, talking to the believing thief, verily I say unto you, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. Now watch. And it was about the sixth hour, and there was darkness over all the earth unto the ninth hour. The sixth hour, the day starts at 6 in the morning. The sixth hour is what we would call 12 noon. Till 3 in the afternoon, that's from 12 to 3. And there's darkness. Verse number 45, and the sun was darkened. Now wait a minute. If there's darkness and the sun is darkened, that's two different things. The physical darkness of the sun, there was also the spiritual darkness. And in the midst of that spiritual darkness, there was a struggle going on. If you come with me to Isaiah chapter 50, Isaiah chapter number 50. All through the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ, he was contending with Satan. And there was a spiritual battle. That's why during the earthly ministry of Christ, there's all this demonic possession. You have the one guy in Mark 5 there who is possessed of devils. And Jesus said, what's your name? And he says, my name is Legion, for we are many. There were thousands. A legion is like a couple of thousand soldiers. There were literally multiple hundreds, if not thousands, of demons possessing that man. And by the way, when Christ's going to cast the demons out of the man, the devils out of the man, where did he send them? They said, don't cast us out of the land. They weren't worried about getting cast out of the man. It was out of the land. There was literally a demonic, the devils, there's the devil with the big D, and then the devils with the little D. The little D guys are the servants of the big D guy. And these devils, we refer to them as demons, they were possessing the land. And there were so many of them had been called into the land to possess it that there were more devils there to possess the land than there were Israelis to occupy. So some of the Israelis had a bunch of them in them. And the concern was, don't throw us out of the land, because they're holding that land, because that's the land where God's going to place his throne. So there's this contest going on. Jesus talks about, if you're going to come in and bind the strong man, if you're going to take his possessions, you got to bind the strong man. So Christ, and he said, that's what I'm doing. I'm casting out the devils. I'm binding Satan. And there's this contest starts with the temptation in Matthew 4, right after Christ is baptized. And Satan is constantly seeking to interfere and defeat the ministry of Christ. Jesus tells him in Matthew 12, when I come and I preach out, I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, the kingdom of God's come to you. There's this contest going on. And it intensifies all along until you come to the moment where you are there at Calvary, where Satan, he puts in the heart of Judas to betray him, and then he personally enters into Judas. So there's this, he comes personally to see that the Lord Jesus Christ is destroyed. Now, in Isaiah chapter 50, you have a prophetic description of these events. I'm just going to start in chapter 50, verse number 4. The Lord God, and see how it's got Lord and that God is all in uppercase letters? Anytime you see the word Lord or the word God in all uppercase letters in a King James Bible, the translators are telling you that the Hebrew name there is Jehovah. Lord, Adonai Jehovah. in your Bible and you see that term Adonai Jehovah, that's God the Father. For God the Father hath given me, that'll be the Lord Jesus Christ, the tongue of the learned, that I should know how to speak a word in season to him that is weary. He waketh morning by morning. He waketh mine ear to hear as the learned. The Lord God hath opened mine ear, and I was not rebellious, neither turned away back. I gave my back to the smiters, and my cheeks to them that plucked out off the hair. I hid not my face from shame and spitting. That's what's taking place in the assault against Christ prior to his crucifixion. In Psalm 22, we'll look at it in a minute, he talks about his feet being pierced. There's no verse in Matthew, Mark, Luke, John that tells you that. If it wasn't for Psalm 22, you wouldn't know that happened. Here when it says he gives his cheek to them that pluck off the hair, if you've ever heard preachers describe Calvary and they talk about pulling off his beard, there's no verse in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John that tells you that. That's the verse that tells you. So what you're doing here is you're seeing the context of the cross. Now verse number 7, for the Lord God will help me, therefore shall I not be confounded. Therefore have I set my face like a flint, I know that I shall not be ashamed. So the Lord Jesus Christ and his mental attitude as he's on the cross is one of confidence in his Father. And he knows he's not going to be confused by what to do. Verse 8, he is near that justifieth me. That's God the Father. Who will contend with me? Let us stand together. Who is my adversary? Now, who is his adversary? The name Satan means the adversary. Let him come near to me. And that's really on the cross in the spiritual battle going on there. Christ is literally challenging Satan. That all you got, dude? Come on, pour it on. Let's see what you got. Now that conflict goes back all the way to Genesis 3:15. The seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent. The seed of the woman is going to destroy, going to crush the head of the seed of the serpent, and in doing it, the seed of the serpent is going to bruise the heel of the seed of the woman. That conflict of the ages is having its strategic victory won by Christ at the cross. And what has happened here is Satan has just been prodded into a bloodthirsty, murderous assault on the Lord Jesus Christ. So there's things going on in the spiritual realm, is my point to you, where the powers of darkness are assaulting the Lord Jesus Christ, and those things are happening. Now, come with me, if you will, to Psalm 22. In the midst of that darkness, in the midst of that physical darkness, where this spiritual conflict is going on, Christ cries out with a loud voice. Now, in the darkness, you can't see it. There are two passages, one in Exodus and one in Genesis, that talk about when God put darkness on Egypt, he said it was a darkness that may be felt. Have you ever been in darkness that you could feel? I remember when I was a kid, if you've ever traveled down around Chattanooga, Tennessee, Lookout Mountain is there. And up on Lookout Mountain, there's a place called Ruby Falls. And if you ever go through the Smoky Mountains or down in that area, you'll see birdhouses and barns and all kinds of places that say, see Ruby Falls. So we were on vacation when I might have been 10, 11 years old. And we were on vacation, and we went up on Lookout Mountain, and my mom and my dad said, let's go see Ruby Falls. So we went to the opening. You pay your money, and you go down. And you literally go down into this cave, and you go deep down into the earth, and there's this falls that you're looking at. It's lighted because they have electricity down in there. But in the journey down, they stop, and then they turn out the lights. Now, if you got the lights turned out here in Chicago, it's never really completely dark. We go down central Illinois. We've been down like Ridge Farm. And you get down there and you get out in those cornfields and it's at night and it gets pretty dark. But it's never completely a complete blackout. You've always got enough, you know, light, ambient light from the stars and so forth that you can see a little bit. In that cave, there was absolutely no dark. If you're in a dark room and you push your eye, the synapses on your eyeball will produce light. You see a light. That's the only light there was down there. That's the day I learned you could do that with your eye, because the guy says, this is total darkness. You're down here in the earth. And you know, it was a creepy thing. I can right now think about it, and it kind of just goes like that on me. You could literally feel that darkness. A total blackout. That's what was going on there in that land. When Christ, there's darkness. Genesis 15, when God cuts the covenant with Abraham, he puts him to sleep, and Abraham experiences what Genesis calls the horror of great darkness. There was a horror in this darkness that could be felt. Well, the Lord Jesus Christ is on the cross, and that darkness that could be felt and the horror that goes on in that was there. And he cries with a loud voice out of the midst of that darkness. And he did it so that you could know what's there. Otherwise, you wouldn't know what's happening. And what he cries, Psalm 22, verse 1, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? So what he's doing on the cross is he's crying out Psalm 22. Now, if you read through Psalm 22, you'll see the first about 18 verses are the events of the cross. And you'll see the physical description. You see the verse 18, they parted my garments among them and cast lots for my vesture. You'll see in John 19, that verse is quoted as what the soldiers are doing there. This whole passage, first and the latter part of it, is about the resurrection and the resultant kingdom that he's going to establish because of that. So when you start the psalm, you're on the cross, you're in the midst of that darkness, and the cry, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? That's what he's experiencing in that darkness. Why art thou so far from helping me and from the words of my roaring? Never before, the Lord Jesus Christ was accustomed to being forsaken by his family, by his neighbors, by his city, by his nation, but never by his Father. John 80 says, thou art with me always. So something's going on in the relationship the Lord Jesus Christ is having with his Father, with God the Father and God the Spirit. And he says, why art thou so far from me? Verse 2, oh my God, I cried in the daytime, during the light, and thou hearest not. And in the night season, the darkness, and am silent, not silent, but thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel. He knows God's holy. He knows the problem is not with the Father or with the Spirit. And he's asked the question, why? Well, obviously, the answer is in the holiness of God. Verse number 4, our fathers trusted in thee. They trusted, and thou didst deliver them. They cried unto thee and were delivered. They trusted in thee and were not confounded. But I am a worm and not a man, and despised of a reproach of men, and despised of the people. Notice how he identifies himself in that. I'm a worm and not a man. Now, when he says that, you can slip over that just real quickly, or you can pay attention to it. When he says, I'm a worm and not a man, a reproach of men and despised of the people, what's happening there in that verse is what Isaiah 53 says, he made his soul an offering for sin. Hold your hand here and come with me to Isaiah chapter 66, the last verse, last part of Isaiah, and Mark chapter number 9. Mark chapter 9. In Mark chapter 9, Jesus is describing for some people what's going to happen to them if they reject him. Mark 9, verse 43. And if thy hand offend thee, cut it off. It's better for thee to enter life maimed than having two hands to go into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched, where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. He describes hell as being a place where their worm dies not, and the fire is not quenched. Notice he does it again in verse 46. He does it again in verse 48. By the way, you have to have a King James Bible to have those verses in your Bible, just in case you have a different kind of Bible. Their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched, is a description of lost people in hell. The fire doesn't go out, and the worm. That's a description. He says in Mark chapter 8, what shall a man get if he gains the whole world and give in exchange for his soul? When you lose your soul, it becomes a worm. Now, a worm, by the way, Job says, though worms eat my flesh. The worm is a maggot in your Bible. So the description, the spiritual description of what happens to a soul in hell is described as a worm. That passage is founded in Isaiah chapter 6. The reason Jesus said that is Isaiah 66, verse number 23. Verse 22, Isaiah 66, verse 22. For as the new heavens and the new earth, which I will make, shall remain before me, saith the Lord, so shall you, your seed and your name remain. Now this is talking about the kingdom. And it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, and from one Sabbath to another, shall all flesh come to worship before me, saith the Lord. And they shall go forth and look upon the carcasses of the men that have transgressed against me, and their worm shall not die, neither shall their fire be quenched, and they shall be an abhorring unto all flesh. That's describing a place located south of the Dead Sea, in the land of Idumea, where at the second coming of Christ there is a shaft there in that location that goes down into hell, into the heart of the earth. And when Jesus Christ comes back, the fire that goes before him, out of the breath of his mouth, Isaiah 34, will literally melt out the earth out of that shaft, and that shaft's going to be there. And in the kingdom, when people come up to Jerusalem to worship, they're going to go out, and there's actually three places they're going to do this. But one of them is they're going to go down into that place, and they're going to be able to look into that pit, into hell, and see the damned. When Jesus said, it's better for you to have your hand cut off than to be cast into hell, the idea there is hell is right there. And in the kingdom, when they sin, boom, instant judgment. And they literally take them and execute them by casting them into there. Now, my point to you is that when Jesus said, I am a worm and not a man, what's he saying? He's saying, I'm experiencing in my inner man, in my soul. I'm making my soul an offering for sin. And he is suffering in his soul the transformation that the Bible describes as the second death. So the reason he would say, I'm a worm and not a man, is because he's literally suffering our second death, our hell and the lake of fire, the second death. Come with me to John chapter 3. This, you know 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse number 21. For God made him to be sin for us. Think about that. He literally made Jesus Christ to be sin. He became the personification of all of man's rebellion and sin. He became a worm, the degenerating effect of all of man's sin he was experiencing. John chapter 3, verse number 14. As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, The serpent in the wilderness was the source of the curse on Israel. And he said, Jesus Christ is going to be lifted up. Just as that serpent, Christ is going to become that for Israel what that serpent was to them. Galatians 3:13, Paul says, Christ was made a curse for us. He literally became so connected and personified with your sin, my sin, that he suffered our second death. That's a, you know, to me, that's a marvelous, wonderful, exciting. God commended his love toward us, and while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He did not just die physically. He first died spiritually, experienced our second death. Then he says, it's finished. The work's done. And then he bowed his head and gave up the ghost and died physically. He did not have to die physically. He died spiritually, made that choice. That spiritual death would have saved you spiritually, but you would still have been in a cursed, sin-cursed body. So he dies physically so he can be physically resurrected so that you can also have a resurrection body. Follow that? So there's two deaths involved there. Now, come with me to 1 Peter chapter 3. So when Jesus Christ said it's finished and he gave up the ghost, he did not need to go. He did not need to do anything more to pay for your sin. It was already done. And when he said it's finished, it was finished. And he didn't then need to go to hell in the heart of the earth to the torment side of hell and dump your sin or suffer for your sin or pay for your sin. It was all done on the cross. So whatever he did after he died, it was not to pay for your sin. He already did that. And it's important to not take away from what he did at Calvary and to say that isn't enough. That he then needed to go, and that's the teaching, that he then went down into the hell compartment, the torment compartment of hell, and somehow dumped your sins there. And that means he didn't finish the work at the cross. And that should be abhorrent to every one of us, to say that the cross wasn't enough. Okay? Now, if you look at 1 Peter chapter 3, here's a passage that is called the dissension passage in Bible commentaries. And this is a passage that is used to describe Jesus Christ after he goes down into the heart of the earth, going over and preaching to the spirits that are in prison. Okay? So this is a passage that is often, the people that say he had to die and go to hell during the 3 days, this is the passage they use to say this is what he did. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. For Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just or the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. So when did he suffer the just or the unjust to bring us to God? Well, that was when he was put to death and when he was resurrected. So we're talking about the cross work. By whom, by which, now that's, he's quickened by the Spirit, by which, by the Spirit, also he went and preached unto the spirits in prison, which sometime were disobedient when once the long-suffering of God waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was preparing, wherein few, that is, eight souls, were saved by fire. So what they do is they take that passage and they say, well, see, what Jesus did was when he died, and he goes down into the heart of the earth, and by the Spirit, he preached to the spirits that are in prison. These spirits that are in prison down there were disobedient back in the days of Noah, and Christ goes down there, and he preaches to them. Now, the difficulty with that is what did he preach to them, and who did he preach to? It says he's preaching to the spirits that were in prison, which sometime were disobedient. He's preaching to lost people in this verse. People say, well, the doctrine gets confusing when people teach it. You hear people preach it. They'll say, well, he went down into the heart of the earth and he preached the victory of Calvary. But who did he preach it to? He preached it to lost people. What value would it be in preaching to lost people in hell about the cross work? It's too late. Follow that? He's not preaching to believers who are in Abraham's bosom. He's preaching to spirits that were disobedient back in the days of Noah. The other thing is, what did he preach to them? Somebody says, well, he preached the victory that he just won at the cross. Well, there's two problems with that. Come back with me to Luke chapter 24. If Christ went into the heart of the earth between his death and resurrection and preached to anybody, but in the passage he's preaching to disobedient spirits, the victory of the cross, there's two things. Number one, the victory of the cross had not been assured yet. What is it that declares him to be the Son of God with power? The resurrection. He's delivered for our offenses. He's raised for our justification. So you have to have the resurrection before the cross work is validated as being the victory. So if he's in hell preaching something, he can't be preaching the victory of the cross because that victory hasn't been demonstrated by the Father by the resurrection yet. Beside that, if he was preaching the victory of the cross and the defeat of Satan, Colossians 2:15, how that he had triumphed over them in the cross, who learned about that first? The demons did. You have to say that before the apostles, before his disciples knew about the victory of Calvary, which had been kept hidden from them, that Christ told Satan and his crowd. Now, you know, you can believe that if you want to, but if you want that to make sense, it doesn't make any sense at all. In Luke chapter 24, verse number 18, on the road to Emmaus, the afternoon of the resurrection, the Sunday afternoon after he has been raised, one of them, whose name was Cleophas, answered and said unto him, art thou only a stranger in Jerusalem and hast not known the things that are come to pass there in these days? And he said unto him, what things? And they said unto him, concerning Jesus of Nazareth, which was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and have crucified him. But we trusted that it had been he which would have redeemed Israel. Beside all this, today is the third day since these things were done. Yea, and certain women also of our company made us astonished, which were early at the sepulchre. And when they found not his body, they came saying that they had seen a vision of angels, which said that he was alive. And certain of them which were with us went to the sepulchre and found that it was as the woman had said, but him they saw not. Then he, that's Jesus, said unto them, O fools and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Here they are on the road to Emmaus, Sunday afternoon after the resurrection, and they still don't understand that he's going to be resurrected. If you go down to verse number 24, he said unto them, and this is his apostles, he's meeting with them in the upper room, these are the words which I spake unto you, when I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled, which were written in the law of Moses and in the prophets and in the Psalms concerning me. Now when he told them those things, back in Luke 18, it says they didn't understand them, they were hid from them. He said, I've told you this, but you didn't get it. Verse 45, then opened he their understanding that they might understand the Scriptures. It's at this point that he tells his apostles and the little flock about the cross and the resurrection, explains to them it was all in the Scripture. But if he was down for 3 days in the heart of the earth telling the spirits that were disobedient in the days of Noah about the victory of the cross, they learned it before the apostles did. That didn't make any sense. And beside that, if you look at Romans chapter number 3, Romans 3, verse 25, talking about Jesus Christ, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. When is that going to be declared? To declare, I say, at this time, his righteousness. The fullness of the revelation of what took place at Calvary isn't recorded in your scripture, made known in your scripture, until you come to the ministry of the Apostle Paul. He began to unveil it in Luke 24 when he opened the apostles' eyes so they might understand the scripture. And then when you come to Paul, he says, you know, wait a minute, there's some stuff about the cross work that isn't in the Old Testament scripture. There's this preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery which kept secret. Now, you're going to go back to 1 Peter. The idea there is that while he was telling all those people in hell this information, declaring the victory, and nobody else knows about it. The idea that he would tell that to somebody before he revealed it to the little flock, or tell it before he revealed it to Paul, just doesn't pass the common sense test. So you say, well, then what if he didn't go down into hell and then preach to the disobedient spirits there, what is this passage in 1 Peter about? Well, if you go back and read it, it makes more sense just to read it and let it be what it is. First Peter 3:19. By which also he went and preached unto the spirits in prison. Who were those spirits? Which sometime were disobedient, when once the long-suffering of God in the days of Noah, when the long-suffering God waited in the days of Noah while the ark was preparing, eight souls were saved by fire. Jesus Christ, by the Spirit that resurrected him, and by the way, if you look back at chapter 1, verse 11, searching what manner of the time the Spirit of Christ which was in them. See that phrase, the Spirit of Christ? That's a reference to the Holy Spirit back in time past. So in chapter 3, verse 19, when he says, by which, by the Spirit of Christ, by the Holy Spirit, he went and preached unto the spirits in prison, which sometime were disobedient, when once the long-suffering of God waited in the days of Noah. It was by the Spirit of God, by the Holy Spirit, that Christ preached through Noah, the preacher of righteousness, to all these people back there before the flood in the days of Noah, preached about the coming wrath and judgment. Now that verse number 21, he says, the like figure whereunto even baptism doth also now save us, not in the putting away the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience toward God by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. In other words, what happened in Noah's day is a picture of what was happening in Peter's day. And what happened in Noah's day? Well, you had the old world. You had the rebellious world. God said, I'm going to judge that world. He preached through Noah for 120 years for men to come and to identify themselves with the ark. Noah builds the ark. Then the flood comes. God's long-suffering waited that 120 years. Then the flood comes. The believers go into the ark. They're saved through the ark onto the new earth and go out and reestablish God's purpose in the earth for man. That's a picture of what's going on with Peter. They're facing the wrath of God, the wrath to come, the tribulation period. God sends out a long-suffering. He says, here, come, join the ark, get in the ark, the little flock. If you're in a little flock, it's your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. The little flock is literally an ark of safety that will carry them through the wrath into the kingdom. That's why it says in verse 21, the like figure whereunto even baptism doth also now save us. Now you think about that. People say, well, baptism can't save you. That verse says it can. But what's it going to save you for? Not the putting away of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience toward God. Acts chapter 2, verse 40, Peter says to the nation Israel, save yourself from this untoward generation. I thought you couldn't save yourself. When he said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, you shall receive for the remission of sin, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Many other words, likewise, one of the other words that he exhort them, saying, save yourself from this untoward generation. When he said, repent and be baptized for the remission of sins, he was saying, save yourself from this generation upon whom the wrath of God's going to fall. Luke chapter 7, he said it with John the Baptist. He said, well, look at it. It's better to read it than me to tell it to you. Luke chapter 7. The blood of bulls and goats couldn't wash away sins. Well, water baptism can't either. But it's a ceremonial cleansing. It's an identification. It's a separating away from the apostate generation upon whom the wrath of God's going to fall, the tribulation. That's exactly what the figure of Noah was. Noah's preaching righteousness. The wrath is coming. Here's an ark of safety. You get in the ark of safety, the water comes, and the water lifts, the wrath lifts you up to safety, and the ark deposits you out on the other side. In Peter's situation, the little flock is the ark of safety. The door into the little flock was water baptism. John was the porter, John chapter 10. Luke chapter 7, verse number 29. All the people that heard him, that's John the Baptist, and the publicans, justified God being baptized for the baptism of John. The baptism of John was not for the putting away of the filth of the flesh. It was the answer of a good conscience toward God. It was the answer of a man who believed what God said, and he'll go and be baptized, the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins, so that he could be separated away from the apostasy of his nation. The verse in Ezekiel 36, verse 25, he says, I will sprinkle you with clean water and cleanse you from your idolatry. And that's what it's about. So he's separating that believing remnant, identifying them together. But the Pharisees, verse 30, and lawyers rejected the counsel of God against themselves, being not baptized of him. That's Peter's saying exactly what Christ did back in Noah's day when he preached long-suffering to those dudes back there who were disobedient. That spirit that he preached to them back there is the same spirit that he's preaching today through us to Israel. And what they are is a figure of what's going on here. The safety is in the ark. The door to the ark is the water baptism. And the like figure whereunto to baptism doth also now save us by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's by his spirit that he's been raised that he's making that offer. So this passage is not talking about Christ going down in after his death into hell and preaching to the lost people in hell some message that he hadn't preached to anybody else. This is a passage talking about the connection between the days of Noah, as it was in the days of Noah, and so shall it be in the days of the Son of Man. So it's an entirely different kind of thing. And this is passage is talking about Christ preaching to those people back in Noah's day. When it says spirits, that's a reference to angels and the connection with the angels and so forth back there. That were involved with man in Noah's day. And Christ didn't personally do, he did it through his spirit. His spirit was in Noah. Noah's a preacher of righteousness. And those people back there had the opportunity to get into the ark and be delivered from the wrath to come. And Peter's issue is, it was that long-suffering. He's the one that says in chapter 3 that God is not slack concerning his promise, but is long-suffering. And he's explaining that. But this stuff in 1 Peter is not talking about what happened between the death of Christ and his resurrection. He's talking about something entirely different. So, what was the question? Did Christ go to hell after he died? The answer is no. Well, the answer is yes. But what part of hell did he go to? He went to paradise. He didn't go to the torment side. And he didn't preach to anybody about the victory of the cross because he hadn't revealed that yet to anybody. He only opens up the eyes of the apostles after his resurrection. And then he only completely reveals it until you come to the Apostle Paul. God kept that information secret until the time came for him to be the due time testifier of it. So, anyway. So did he go to hell? No, he suffered your second death on the cross. When he said it's finished, it was done. Over with. Don't take anything away from the finality of his work at Calvary. Okay? And don't get involved in the old wives' fables either. Okay, my wife's looking at her watch. That means we're through. Your wife's coming home soon, right? Be a happy camper. All right, praise the Lord. It was nice to see so many people back this morning that we haven't seen in such a good long time. And it's just amazing to see these young people grow a foot since the last time you saw them. So we had a good morning. By the way, that one pew, two behind where Tom is there, that one set of benches, this morning was the only row that wasn't filled. And the man that was sitting on the end was a visitor. He just came for his first time today, heard the radio. So he felt kind of lonesome, I guess, on that pew. But it was nice to see a good, folks come. And you pray for them. It's no mark of shame or embarrassment when people are hesitant to get out in this day and age. But right now, when they look like they're trying to lift things, it's in spring is here. So praise the Lord for the opportunity. Father, we thank you tonight for your love and your grace to us in Christ Jesus. And we thank you for our Savior. And Father, we don't want anything that we teach, that we believe, that we say, or that we think, that would diminish even one small particle away from what our Savior accomplished for us on the cross. We thank you for that. And we thank you when he said it's finished, that it was done, and that we can rest in the finality of that cross and rejoice in the experiencing of the reality of the resurrection life. In Christ's name, amen.